And then what happened?
He got in touch with Vietnam, and he found out that he and so many others, six I think, had gone out on a patrol that morning, and that they had been attacked, and that they had all survived, and they'd gotten back to camp. And that he told me some other things. I'll have to think about it, because it's been a long time since I had anybody to talk to about it. But he said that John was okay, and that he would send word to write to me and see that he would have to. Somebody was going to not only tell him to write to me, but he was going to see that he mailed the letter. And he did. But
when John got back, he never talked about it to us either.
Never talked to anybody, no. He had a friend that was in Vietnam with him that came down, skinny boy. I don't know whether he had any family to come back to or where he was even from. It was somewhere like Tennessee or something. But he came down to Daytona. John had asked him to come down. And he came down, and I've got a picture of him on the back porch. We had room for a table back there. I say a table. It was a great big piece of Florida Allen Mike. Things they used to hold the wire in.
Yeah, that's the table. We picked those up off the street.
Yeah, and it was a big one, 16 or more. And I put it on the back porch, and that's what we ate off of. But that's when those two friends come. John had already, y'all had made the apartment for him upstairs. And they stayed upstairs with him for a couple of days.
A lot of John's friends did not come back.
No, they didn't.
One day he asked why he came back. Why him? When his friends did not. But we're glad he did come back.
And to think he married that girl who was the youngest colostomy survivor in the United States. And she had been pregnant by the son of somebody worked for the telephone company, babe. He'd gotten her pregnant. Been wanting a part of it, though. But she had the baby. Little boy, put it up for adoption. But John had met her, and she was very cute but depressed. And so he married her. And she divorced him just before Christmas because he didn't write often enough. Kept everything he had, all of his clothes, his records, his music things, everything. Pictures. After he was dead, I saw her somewhere. She came by or something, apologized. She was sorry she treated him like that. Thanks a lot. But he came back and thanked God for Donna Cuda. Did you ever know Donna Cuda?
I'm not sure I did. Tell me about Donna.
Donna, John knew when they were in Lenox Avenue School. And then John, with whom I don't know why, he stopped seeing her. But she had gotten married. She had a little boy named Tony. Tony Cuda. No phone.
No.
And
when John came back home, did he see her again?
Yeah. She kept in touch with us, and she was friend of everybody, and Shannon took her to the prom. She made the dress, she came and stayed with me, sewed the dress the night before. went to the prom with Shannon. And then she came back, when John came back, brought a little boy over. And then she started staying with John. We had made a home for him in the garage. Did you ever go there?
The garage apartment or the garage?
That's the garage. Yeah. Paneled it, put lights in them, furniture. Then the neighbors complained because he didn't have a bathroom, and they complained that he might be dirtying up the world. Sent the police over. They got him out of bed. Took him to jail. Got him there, found out they didn't have any laws, that he owned the place. You know, it was his family's home. He wasn't renting it. He went inside to use the bathroom, and everything was okay, so we turned him loose, and he had to walk home in his underpants.
I guess Billy Willits wasn't chief of police then.
No. Came home, grew marijuana. Did you hear about that?
No.
He bought some pot instead of smoking, and he planted it. He got 14 of the biggest marijuana plants you ever saw or dreamed of seeing in your life. He fertilized them, he watered them, he kept a bright light on them all night long. Beside the garage and along the fence, it was all in the backyard behind the house. And then after, the neighbors had complained about him living in the garage, and they were afraid he'd set fire to the place and burn them out. They got the police to come and take him to the police station. And they turned him loose, and when he got home, I found out where he had been. They didn't tell me. He didn't call me. He didn't have any money. And I got afraid. Very much afraid that they'd find the pot. There it was. It was 14 feet high. Trees. 14 feet is tall. I said, John, you've got to get rid of it. You've got to get rid of it. Well, he did everything but just really cry. But we dug all up the west side of the house and we buried him. He didn't take one cigarette worth. Chopped them all up. Put them down in the trench and covered them up.
And he cried some more.
We all cried.